Kharif season is almost over and Rabi is about to begin, but the picture looks no brighter. The Rabi crop production is expected to shrink this time around. This as Rabi sowing reduced by about 4% year-on-year basis. And add to that the rains and hailstorms in North India, which partly have damaged the standing crop as well. In fact, due to all of these factors, India's Rabi output is expected to reduce by almost 10% for the financial year 18-19. The harvesting of Rabi crop has begun and seasonal supply pressure is gradually building in these commodities. And as a result, prices have plunged in the last fortnight. Prices of many Kharif oil seeds and pulses are now 10 to 30% below their minimum support prices. This even as Kharif crop numbers show lower than last season. Hello and welcome to Commodity Champions, your weekly dose of what's brewing in the commodity space. I'm Anisha Gupta and today we will discuss the growing concerns on bearish prices of the Rabi crops. Joining me on the discussion are Madan Sabnavis, Chief Economist at Care Ratings, and Devendra Pant is Chief Economist at India Ratings. Gentlemen, hi, thank you so much for joining us. Mr. Pant, hi, let me come to you first. And while there have been some concerns on the Rabi crop, first on the sowing part of it, and then, of course, we've seen unseasonal weather in sense of drought in some states, rain and hailstorms in the northern part of India. What is your sense? Even if we get the numbers right, do you think there are concerns about the yield or perhaps the quality of Rabi crop now?
There will be some impact. Fortunately, what has happened, the hailstorms which has occurred, say, 15 days or a month back in the northern part, fortunately, they were not that widespread among the major producing areas. So there will be impact, and more so the kind of hailstorm and the rains which I'd seen in northern area and mainly the wheat growing areas, that most of the crops will be able to withstand. But yes, if the intensity of hailstorms and excessive rainfall happens, because what is going to happen, the prolonged winter which we are seeing in the up north after a long gap is ideally good for wheat crop. But yes, if the hailstorm and the rainfall intensity increases, there will be an impact on output.
Madan, what is your sense? What are your initial numbers that you are working with in sense of the Rabi crop this time around? It is expected lower than previous year, and especially after we have seen those back-to-back bumper record crops, really.
Yeah, I think a number of factors which are working towards indicating towards that a lower Rabi crop. See, if you also look at the area under cultivation that has been adverse for something like pulses, it's been just about normal for wheat. And in terms of oil seeds, it's maybe marginally all right, better. Of course, cereals seem to be down. But now the additional factor about the rather strange weather which we have had in some of the northern states, I think that really does indicate that overall we could be expecting to see some kind of pressure in terms of lower Rabi crop. Now, what would this really mean? This would actually mean that in terms of supplies, I don't see too much of a problem when it comes to wheat, because we do have adequate buffer stock, so I don't think that should be an issue. But I think it goes back to the same issue of things like pulses and oil seeds, because in case there's going to be any kind of distortion, there could be certain upward pressure on prices. Now, so far the conditions have been rather good for the consumer, not so good for the farmers, because we've seen prices going below the MSP and the farmers have been at certain amount of distress. And I think that's been beneficial for the overall headline inflation number, because food inflation numbers come down lower. But definitely, to my mind, I think at least some of the Rabi crops would begin to show positive tendencies when it comes to inflation. And overall food inflation, which has been fairly benign, could see some kind of an upward movement.
I get your point about lower crop and prices perhaps going higher. That's quite textbook, really. But Mr. Pant, the point that we see right now is that as the harvest season commences, as we see arrivals actually increase, many of the commodity prices actually have been yet again under pressure. At least that is what the data in the last fortnight shows. So a good crop or a bad crop, sufficient buffer stock with the government, I think that is what the markets really are looking at. So you haven't really seen very long positions being created or stockists actually going out and buying many of these commodities. The procurement from government also is something that is coming quite delayed, etc. How are you looking at all of these issues?
Taking over from what Madan had just said, and this is the unfortunate situation right now, because whatever government has tried, whether increasing MSP because of increase in the productivity, whether we look at the grains or food grain, or whether we look at the horticulture crops. So basically, we are talking about fruits, vegetables, and everything. Over the years, the production has increased. Now, what has happened is we are producing more than what we require, and buffer stock norms are there. But our central pool stocks, or the stocks of the government, of wheat and rice is almost double of what are the buffer stock norms, and they are putting a downward pressure on prices. Now, we have increased MSP to 1.5 times of the cost of production. But reality, we know what is happening in the market. Farmers are not getting that price. And in fact, the market prices are for some crops maybe is around 30-40% below the MSP. So farmers are not benefiting. We are spending a lot of money in storage and distribution. So the food subsidy bill is rising. What we are trying to do is we have had almost all states, or many states are doing your debt waiver. So we have the debt waiver. There is a fiscal impact. We are increasing MSP. There is a fiscal impact. We are now the last. What government has done it through the budget is providing 6,000 rupees per annum to small and marginal farmers. Now that is the one thing which will go to the farmer. If we have everything in place, all the land records digitized and the accounts are linked with that, so there will be some direct money transfer to them. But because of overproduction or the supply exceeding demand and a ban on the exports, we are not able to export. This is the situation where the farmers are in. So the prices are, although one would argue they can't remain negative or low for forever. But chances of the, even if we have a hit of say 5% or so, because it is too early to say the 10% hit on the Rabi production.
Okay.
So even if it is 5% or 4% decline in the output, it is unlikely to change prices or the food price inflation or food inflation. Unlikely to change it very significantly. There may be some, because what we look, you look at the farmers being, though they are generally, we say, they are not well informed and other things.
Sure.
What you will see when the prices of pulses are too high, everybody has sown pulses.
Right.
Next year when the pulses prices will fall, they will not sow pulses.
Absolutely.
So these kind of issues. So what we required, maybe some sort of extension facility where the farmers get all this information and they can get the best out of it.
Your point is well taken. Madan, the same question to you, really. We are aware of the issues here. And we were doing an exclusive story on CNBC TV 18 today on how on Friday, perhaps 1.2 crore farmers would be given the first tranche of the assured income. That number, of course, is expected to go higher. By 31st March, the government say that it is likely that all the 12 crore farmers would be covered here. But even with that, what is your sense? What more needs to be done on ground in a more structural way to ensure that the kind of situation that the farmers all over India are right now, with many states doing various things, centered trying its bit, what really needs to be done?
No, I think there is some bit of hyperactivity when it comes to the farmers today, because we have seen that in the state elections, the results went against the ruling government, and it was felt it was mainly because of farmer distress. Now, what's been the problem here in Indian farming is that we tend to take things one thing at a time. So at one point of time, you said, okay, the income is not rising, so therefore we increased MSPs, but we don't really have a procurement system. At certain other points of time, we say that let's have some kind of insurance which is being given through the government scheme. But the problem is that we don't have an integrated solution. And while all of us talk, it sounds very easy that we need to have an end-to-end solution where we look at not just the productivity part, but the logistics, the marketing, the exports. I think it all fits into one particular picture. Unfortunately, it's always kind of doing it in little pieces. And that's the reason why we don't really get significant results. And most of the time, like here, we are getting another elections coming on. So therefore, the idea is that let's make sure that the farmers get a certain amount of income. Now, in fact, one reason why I still believe that the prices voters would tend to move in the upward direction is that to make their conviction look more real, I think the government will ensure that the MSP is more effective for the Rabi season, because it's going to happen in the months of March, April, maybe a little bit of May. This is exactly the time when they're going to have elections. So we'll have to appeal to the farmers to make sure that you have an effective procurement system, not just for wheat, but probably also for something like oil seeds through some of the cooperatives. So I think that's what's going to really happen. But in terms of what you've said, yes, we need to have an end-to-end solution. I think all of us know about it, but for some reason, we're not really concentrating on it. The budget will say, okay, let's have something for seeds, let's have something for oil seeds, something for pulses. Yeah. At certain points of time, we talk of irrigation, we talk of ENAM, but actually getting everything together to work together is not really happening. And I think the ultimate thing is that you say we give cash to farmers, which means we're ignoring everything in agriculture and say that, look, if you want to live, we're going to give you 6,000 rupees and say that that's going to be a kind of a solution. But that's not the kind of a medium-term solution for agriculture in India.
Oh, that point is so well taken. Thank you so much, Madan and Mr. Pant, for joining us today. Well, that is what both our experts are telling us, that even with a 4-5% decline in the Rabi crop, it's not going to make too much of unlikely to change food situation in India. And as Madan was also saying, that the government needs to look at an integrated end-to-end solution. And that perhaps is the need of the hour. India's milk production is increasing on a yearly basis, making it the global leader. It grew 6% in 2018, making India's market a 6 trillion rupees dairy market. The credit here goes to government interventions in terms of building infrastructure for production, processing and marketing. These steps will help increase milk production to 250 million tons in next 3 years. And one of the biggest beneficiaries of these government measures has been Amul, where products are available in 5 million stores in India. Joining me today on the show is R.S. Sodhi, who is Managing Director at Amul. Mr. Sodhi, hi, welcome to the show. Let me begin by asking you about, the government, of course, has talked a lot about agriculture and farmers, but in the interim budget, they also spoke about animal husbandry. That also has found a mention and attention from the government. How is the sector reacting to this? How beneficial do you find it? And what more would you want the government to do in this space now?
You see, some initiation has been done, but I still feel our authority has to still understand more about the contribution of dairy and animal husbandry sector in the rural economy. No doubt in this budget, there have been 2-3 benefits given, like credit card scheme, Kisan credit scheme, 2% interest subvention and 3% if they pay at the right time. Also, there is a 750 crore rupees for the Gokul mission or Rashtriya Kamdhenu Yog. These are very, very small things. So there are major things which I think governments are taking look at. You see, animal husbandry contributes 30% to the agriculture economy or agriculture GDP. But if you see state government or the central government budget allocation is not more than 5-10%. So if any sector is giving you 30%, why not whatever budget we set in for the agriculture, 30% should be go for the animal husbandry. And you see, in animal husbandry, all help, all support, all funds are also going to landless also, marginal also, farmers who are having less than a hectare. And 80% of Indian farmers are landless and marginal. And you see, first of all, on animal husbandry or dairy, there is an income tax. Whereas on cultivation, there is no income tax. Agriculture, when you say agriculture is a priority sector, dairy is not included. Third thing, on all agriculture, whether it's a fruits, vegetable, you there's no tax. But when it comes to dairy products, you take example of ghee, which farmers is selling milk and buying ghee, there are 12% GST on an average. And this tax, people feel consumer is paying. No, if farmers is paying less price for their milk. On a liter, on a 1 kg of ghee, farmers is bearing around 4-5 rupees per kg as GST. So I think these are the sectors where really central government and state government look into. And if they really want to provide very sustainable livelihood to the rural Indians, livelihood, they have to give due importance.
Well, that point is well taken. I will come back to the dairy as a sector yet again. But Mr. Sodhi, we do learn that fruit juice is something that Amul also is looking at. Now, this is quite a competitive sector and not exactly your area of expertise because you have been into dairy all of these decades. So what is the rationale behind this foray? How exciting does the space look to you?
You see, Amul is mainly in the dairy and we have been growing. If you see our CAGR is 16 to 17%, will continue to grow. We are getting more milk, but also because we are in food and Amul is India's biggest food company, we always look for the opportunity. And then one opportunity which we found is entering into juice based drinks, and that is where, because we have got a lot of capacities, especially during winter and other time when we for the packaging and processing. So just to take care of those excess capacities, we want to process and pack real fruit-based juices. Also, we like to add some milk solids in that to make it more tastier and healthier. And we already have got a very good distribution network. And coming to the competitiveness, you see, Amul has got core competence in giving a very good product with using the latest packaging in a very, very efficient way, because our supply chain is very efficient and we are able to provide to our consumers a good product at value for money and healthy too. And I think in this juice-based drink, brand name is TRU, T-R-U, and we are going to launch in a PET bottle at 10 rupee MRP, and whatever initial survey and feedback we have got, we have got a very good response, and I think we'll set the new bench levels for everybody, that if Indian market you want to provide any drink or fruit-based drink, this is going to be the price level.
Okay, so just for the understanding, what is the total market for fruit-based juices in India, and what is Amul looking to achieve in sense of a market share there? What really has been your maths into this?
I think fruit-based juice drinks is market is around more than 5,000 crore or 6,000 crore, and we'd like to do at least 1,000 crore rupees business out of fruit juice-based drinks.
Just coming back to what really is happening in the country, there has certainly been a government thrust on agriculture with policies, as you also mentioned. This is an election year. It has caused uncertainty, political uncertainty in the country. Once all of this subsides, how would you look at 2019 for the sector overall then?
Well, as far as you see, Amul is there for last 72 years. Various political parties have come to the center as well in the state, because Amul is owned by, or Indian dairy sector is owned and run by the cooperatives, which are owned by the farmers. We have found that whichever government is there in central state, all are always very favorable to the cooperatives or the farm institutions. All governments have helped farmers institutions to work very efficiently. So for Amul or for any dairy cooperative, it does not matter which government is in the center or state. Every government has been supporting and going to support farm institution like Amul.
Mr. Sodhi, also let's talk about the latest in the technology, and Amul has been making tie-ups with various online distributors. E-commerce as a business, of course, has been on an increase. What have been the numbers for Amul, and are there any more tie-ups like that in pipeline?
E-commerce is a very growing segment. Already, Amul, around 2% of our business has started coming from e-commerce. And e-commerce, we have found there are two types of e-commerce. One is the regular e-commerce like Big Basket, etc., where they are give you grocery or refrigerated products, you book, order, and then. So that is for Amul also, and that is for lots of other grocery and food products. But the other e-commerce which is coming up in many, many numbers is morning milk delivery system. I have found that each city, there are one or two or three startups or youngsters who have started booking your milk, eggs, bread, dahi, paneer, or other dairy products order on the app in the evening up to 8 o'clock. And early morning when you wake up, it is there on your door. That business is growing very well. These all new e-commerce guys are approaching us and they want to tie up with Amul to get our dairy products to supply every day to the customer. So now e-commerce where everyday delivery is getting. And for Amul it is good. Reason is that e-commerce you can launch niche product like we have lactose free milk. It is doing very good on e-commerce. Similarly, camel milk. Because otherwise reaching this scattered consumer is very difficult. But on e-commerce, it is easy to reach to the small number of customers. And I feel it will go. Only thing is, in India, the supply chain margins are very low. In case of milk, from factory to consumer, we pay only 5% margins. So in e-commerce, naturally, they have to make their supply chain very efficient so that their expenses are not more than the existing supply chain margins of milk or other food products.
All right, Mr. Sodhi, thank you so much for joining us. Always a pleasure to speak to you. Well, that's the view coming in from Amul, 72 years of Amul in the country. And as they said, they have worked with various governments all of these years and all of them have been favorable to the cooperative system that they run. And of course, it is about the fruit business that they are looking forward to now in the days to come. But with that, that's all the time that we have on this edition of Commodity Champions. Thank you for watching.